My name is Michael Olafusi, and the whole essence of so I'm going to share my screen again, and this time around I'm going to share the entire screen so that it will be a bit easier for you to follow along. So as you can see, this is the number sixth one, which means there have been number one, number two, number three, number four, number five, and more importantly, this is the platform where all this happens. So which means that if you want to get to know what you've missed before now, so let me just go and grab you this link. You can always go here and join, so you will never really miss anyone. Going to paste that in the chat box. So I'm pasting the joining the community link. Join the community. And for those of you who missed the previous sessions, I'm going to paste where you can watch the previous sessions. Okay, and so, what is the aim of these weekly sessions we have? It is much more about three things. One is showing you what's new. So there's the teaching you what hopefully you don't know yet, or maybe you know, but a different perspective. So there's that part of it. Then there's the communication side. So we want it to be richer. We want you to talk back, share your own experience, ask questions, share your doubts. So that one too. So they will be more like equal weighting. Say we have 1 hour. I can spend like 20 minutes on what I want you to learn that I feel some of you will not know yet or that is valuable for everyone. And then maybe like 20 minutes, we talk around people's questions. And then also too, there's the allowing you to take control. So if there's anybody who has something to share, like maybe you want to teach, not a question now, something that you've encountered, you want to share, or maybe someone even have a problem with a model and he wants us to fix it and he's okay with us fixing it live, right? Like fixing the, especially those of you taking our training. So some people have contacted me like, oh, they have a problem somewhere, or they are trying to adapt the model for their own particular company or a friend startup. Yeah, those kind of stuff that we can do here right now and everybody can benefit. And you can see how in a daily life case, we think through all of these processes. Yeah, so I'm going to start with the first side, which is me teaching you what I think maybe you don't know yet. So interestingly, since you can see my screen, I can quickly show you some background to what you are going to check here now, right? So I'm going to be facilitating a class that, well, it's going to be virtual, but if not because of coronavirus, it will be something that is supposed to happen in UK. And let me just show you. And I just want you to understand what I want to show you right now. So I want to tell you the big picture. In our Nigerian training, we typically, because most companies in Nigeria are more of the traditional manufacture something, sell service, not service as a software kind of companies. I don't think I've yet modeled for any company in Nigeria that is doing software as a service. So before now, most of the models that I do for people in or even in our training are models that they are much more for manufacturing, the kind of businesses that we have in Nigeria. I'm currently doing for two companies right now. One is in the mining space. The other one is in FMCG. And so I just want to now share with you, because of that, I had to recreate some of my templates and start doing the one that fits into a startup. So today's special, there are two things I'm going to teach us today. So those two things are, how do you model for companies, the traditional ones that we know, and then the, in case you are even interested in this, though it's kind of pricey. They didn't price it for Nigerians, so they priced it in they priced it in pounds. Okay. So I'm not surprised if many of us will not find the price kind of attractive, but we never can tell. We might have people who have plenty of money right now. All right, so that is the background to what I want to share with us. I'm going to open my Excel file. Excel. Okay, great. So I'm going to start with a company that is the traditional Nigerian type of company. So I'm going to go to because of confidentiality, I'm not going to use real work, you know, real company. But I tell you, everything I'm showing you is exactly as it is for companies that are real, that are Nigerian companies, and some other. Sometimes too, I've had to model for foreign companies, and it's similar, just a bit of tweak, you know, because every company's product line and structure are a bit different, but the general approach is the same. So let me just check if anybody, maybe I will just set the, because right now what it does is anytime people try to join, it tells me they're in the waiting room. So we have 15 people. If you have any questions, always feel free to stop me and ask. All right, so when we talk about financial modeling, what is actually financial modeling? Okay, so financial modeling is really, increase, let me type it in. So financial modeling is going to have to zoom now. And if you have any question, feel free to ask me. So financial modeling is the representation of a company in terms of its financials. It sounds a bit simplistic, but it's complete. And when I start showing you the patterns to it, you will understand. So it's when we talk about financial modeling, essentially, if you're in a business, you're in a business because of financial profit. Nobody's set up a business, you know, and it doesn't care about the finance part. You know, it just, you know, wants the business to be alive. You know, no, if that's the case, you probably never need to do financial modeling because, well, it's not important for you whether how your financials are like. So, but the moment that you care about your financials, you care about your income, your expense, your assets, your financial resources, and more importantly, the moment you start trying to get investors, aha, you have to even show them what your plans are. And so you find out that that requires that you have to have your company already represented in a model, you know, something that I can look at. I'm here in Nigeria, maybe you are here somewhere else in Nigeria, or you're outside of the country. I can look at it, I can get a full understanding of what your business is. That's why some people can invest in a company in Nigeria and they're in US, and they don't have to come here physically and start taking a stock of what you have and physically examining things. It's because there's a financial model they can look at. There's a model. There's not only financial models that are the only models. So sometimes you have business case models, you have business canvas model. There are many kinds of models. So that's why in my definition, I talked about the financials. So model essentially is just to show someone, you know, how this thing really is in real life, without the person having to physically come and examine that real life sort of, right? So these are some of the materials we use to help people come up to speed with understanding what it is. So financial modeling is a representation of a company's entire finance, you know, so the financial position, the enterprise value, through flexible calculations that are built on sound financial knowledge. So if you are someone interested in financial modeling, you know, number one is you need to have a sound finance background, accounting. You know, accounting is the language of finance. So definitely they go hand in hand. But the thing is just that somebody who just knows the accounting knowledge is the equivalent of somebody in commerce class in secondary school. If you can't finance it, what ties it to real life? So the moment, just like you speaking English, but communication is not just English. So accounting is like English, while communication is like finance. So that's why embedded in this finance is accounting, kind of. And then the second important thing is the company, right? So you build financial models for companies. You don't build them for, because I've seen people, you know, say, oh, okay, I want to do a financial model. And guess what? They just want to analyze their income and expense. So it could be personal, it could be maybe for a cooperative they are part of, it could be for a body they are part of, No, when we're talking about financial model, is a company, a corporate entity that you do a financial model for. And then also too, there are three kinds of models that you need to be aware that exists. So there are going to quickly, if you have any question, please feel free to ask at any point. Do I have two screens, but they are positioned differently, so it's I'm effectively using one screen. So if you type, I might not see on time, but if you ask, I will see on time, but once in a while I will check. So in the financial modeling space, there are three. There's the regular financial model, which you will have to build the income statement or the statement of profit or loss statement. You will have to build the balance sheet or the statement of financial position. You will have to build the cash flow. And it can be three way, it can be, but three way is the appropriate one where everything is relinked to themselves. The income statement feeds the balance sheet feeds the cash flow, part of the cash flow comes back and feeds the balance sheet. And then even the cash flow still goes and feed the income statement, as regards to interest, financing cost and finance interest. So there's that one. Then there's project finance. There is also project finance model. Project finance models are the ones where, take for instance, we all know the Lekki concession company, that toll gate. In the beginning, it's going to have to be fleshed out as a project finance. Because typically people will not be interested in an income statement balance sheet and cash flow. They are much more interested in cash flow. We put our money in, how our money is going to come out. And sometimes when you get project financing, so for instance, you want to engage in, so especially in mining and oil and gas, this is very common where some people come together to develop an oil field and they are interested in a project finance model for that. So they don't do a traditional financial model. So financial model, and there's a template. In fact, there's a certification for financial model. There's no certification for project finance model because project finance model is always very specific to the project. I can't show you real life work, but if it's oil and gas, then you're going to want to take into factor the lifespan of that of that oil field, how much is there in the reserve, then whatever proof financing you are getting. So if you are getting loan from bank, what are the years that you're supposed to use to pay back, and then so they sometimes they build a cash flow waterfall where they're like, okay, when revenue comes, they're going to take like, and then you take your cost of production, the ones that you must satisfy, then also immediately they can decide that they want to take, 5% to repay, to whatever tranches, you could even have different tranches of funding. So it's very specific that everything about it is codified in the get-go, that this is how this project is going to be financed. And this is how sometimes you might set up an SPV. So the companies might decide that, you know what, we are going into this as an SPV, as a joint venture. That's why in the oil and gas, there are so many joint ventures. So similarly too, also for real estate, same thing too. I could be a real estate company, and then I come to you, you have a land in Ikoyi, and maybe a sizable land, and I'm like, okay, you know what, we're going to partner with you. You provide us the land, we fund the building of an high-rise building, of a high-rise building there, and then, maybe over 20 years, all the money will be ours, and then after that, the property become yours. So again, people build a project finance model for that kind. So for projects where every aspect of it is to be controlled, you know how much you want to charge per rent, you know how many rooms you're going to have, you can reasonably say this is how much you're going to increase the rent, and this is occupancy rate. The same way for oil and gas, so they know how much oil they can pump out, at least they can know it anyway, so they can put it in the project that, we're going to, part of the due diligence is getting experts to verify for us how much reserve is there, how much you can pump out. The variables are not so much they try to control as much as possible on like a financial model. A financial model, we can build a financial model even for a startup without the startup having to go and commission a company to do some elaborate analysis and due diligence for them. Why? Because we will just do it in a monthly way. So the moment you start, you get going. As July ends, you replace July forecast with July actual. And the moment you see the reality, you see how off you are from your forecast, you can adjust the forecast. For project finance, you know, because everything is codified, you know, you want to spend more time doing the due diligence. Sometimes they spend 1 year or 1 year and a half plus or 1 year more to codify all the terms before they commit. Whereas financial model, even when the thing is an idea, we can get going with the financial model. So it's common in things like real estate projects or business, mining businesses, some kind of expansion projects, SPVs, sometimes even public-private partnerships. Those are the kind of things So typically when you're talking with someone and he wants to do a financial model, sometimes you want to be sure when you listen to what they are saying, because some people don't really know that all these things are different. So someone will come to us and say he wants to do a financial model. By the time he explains what he wants, they used to be like, all these financial model stuff are kind of like blabberdash or things that people just say just to get money, get their money. That they know people who raise money and never did any kind of crazy financial model. It's because when it comes to valuation, the people you are dealing with might want to get a DCF kind of valuation, which is the one that then you definitely must do a financial model. Some other times, which a lot of times they might just want comps. So they want to know what is your user base, so they just have some ratios that they want to use to come up to a value for you. So maybe they will value your users at $5 per user, and then they ask you what are your active users. So they use some like kind of ratios, industry multipliers. And so you find out that because for startups, most angel investors and VCs, they know that you can never be very accurate. So for them, they have rule of thumbs, and they just ask for some basic things, and they try and do the term sheet in such a way that they have more control, so they can control the direction of the company. They have a network they can make you tap into. So they have a way of them making sure that when they buy you, they can realize what it is that they want, or when they invest, they can realize what it is that they want. So they are not so hung up on the traditional financial model type of coming up to how to value you. So you just see that they just sometimes have their own spreadsheet they send to you and say, fill it and send back to them those details, and then send us your business model canvas, send us, you know, your team. So they also are careful about the team, and then they just make their decisions based on that. So just because it goes that way doesn't mean that it means financial modeling not lose its value. It's just a case of if the company is not interested in this evaluation, then you might never need to do a financial model. It's only this evaluation that requires financial modeling. So there are other model types anyway. So I just wanted you to be aware that also in this evaluation too, if you're in stock investment too, this is also the approach we use. So maybe you buy stocks, you buy corporate stocks listed on the stock exchange. This is the approach. You can decide to use anything. Like for me, I have some companies that I value using DCF to come to what their fair value is. But so even in Nigeria right now, all those things don't make sense anymore. The market does not reflect that. So sometimes you will still see that we go and start using the comps. We start using, okay, what's the PE ratio, price to earning ratio? What is the what are the technical signals? So we start using on some other things that, you know, no longer do you need to do financial models to achieve them. So any question at this juncture? Let me just see if I can pull up one. Okay, this should be one. So this is one I have for Dangote Cement. So this now, if I'm interested in valuing Dangote Cement, so, and I'm using the DCF valuation, right? So DCF valuation means I do the financial model, get the historical from as far back as I'm comfortable with, then up onto their last statement. And then after, I think some people are trying to join. Let me just see, admit all. Okay. All right. Sorry for that. Is there a way to mute all? Let's see if I can mute every. Okay, great. So if let me just check if people have asked any questions yet. Can I ask questions on Excel or different from the topic of discussion? Yes, you can. Great. So back to what I was saying. So for Dangote Cement, I got the historicals, I got everything, and then I moved on to my forecasting, the normal financial model that we will build to do forecast. Just that this time around, I'm doing a top-down because I don't really know the unit economics of Dangote Cement. So I use the top-down. I just like say, okay, what if they grow revenue, you know, in some rate? And then, but with that, I'm able to come up with what I think Dangote's fair value is. So using that approach and this evaluation, I'm like, okay, Dangote is what? 195 naira per share. And then what do? I go online and go and check what the current price of Dangote is. And then when I check it, I see, is it selling at a premium or at a discount? Okay. So that falls under this. So there are many methods. I can decide that I want to use comps. Comps is, okay, what is the P ratio? What is the industry average, you know, that companies in that sector are selling for? Then do I think Dangote is selling at a premium to the industry average or at a discount? So by the way, if you're interested in this dashboard, I'll share you the link so I can go to where I can pick the companies individually and I can go and look for Dangote. So this is Dangote. Dangote is currently selling at 126 naira per share. So I could be like, okay, this looks like a buy signal for me, like selling at a discount to what my valuation has come to. And I can decide to do a dividend discount model. So in dividend discount model, I don't even care about the financial model. All I care about is what is this dividend that Dangote shares pay, and then how does it typically grow the dividend? And I use that, they call it Gordon growth model. But all these are English. The key thing is, once you understand what we are trying to do, you can always Google out the formula to use or even just use templates. So that's why sometimes some people who don't even care to do the thing themselves, they just come for training or learn it so that they understand how it's done. And they just be using template as long as they understand the logic. Okay. And if you're the kind of person that still wants to check out the... So, for some other people that they are more interested in technicals, they will just be like, I don't care about all those calculations. Can I just see what the price trend has been? Can I see? I will share you the link of where you can access this anyway. So any questions so far before I now go to startup? So that is the thing about the different financial models. Or when people talk about financial models, the different kind of things that when you ask questions more, and you now start being able to understand what it is they really want. So you don't just go and assume that everything is always one type. Okay. All right. So any questions so far? Now let's talk about a startup. So there are two kinds of startup that you will typically model for. There's the startup that... let me close this. There's a startup that is the type that you will have more in Nigeria, where they are manufacturing physical products, and when you look at their, when you look, think of their business plan, you will be able to break it down into something like this. So you'll be able to say, okay, they have, in this case, this company has four products that they manufacture, right? And then you'll be able to break it down into what is the volume they intend to produce based on their factory capacity, their utilization, and then all the other things that staff and all of those things that they are going to marshal, resources they will put together. Then what is the unit price? And then what is the unit cost? So all of this, we call it the unit economics. So once you have that unit economics, which is like unit price, unit costs, unit number of volume or units they will sell, then with that, sometimes you might need them to do some kind of markets feasibility study, go and find out what the average price in the market is, how much it costs other producer to make it, to come up with a representative figure for this. And then when they look at the factory they are setting up and the number of staff they can enroll and how soon they can ramp up production, they can be able to come up with the figures of, you know, volume per year. And then that captures what you will now use to estimate what to be the volume, I mean revenue, which is this. So revenue that they're going to make from all of those products, and what will be the cost of sales, the direct cost they are going to incur. Okay, so you find out that typically for us now, when we want to model for companies, we just extract this sheet. I take this sheet out, and I take it as a file in itself. So this would be a file that's the only thing in that file. I will not put all these figures. So if you are the one trying to engage us, I will just put your own product here. So if you have three products, that means I will delete this number four and put your product one, product two, product three. I'll delete all these figures. And if you tell me your company started in 2018, then I will not have this. I'll start from where your company starts, so you can give me the historical, and I will send it to you. So let's come to this section of it. The general and admin expenses. So because, again, we want to be as granular as possible. So you see, we don't just bundle them as G&A or admin expenses. We start breaking them down into the components that are possible. How much you're going to pay for professional fees and consulting, business development and whatsoever. Directors, if you have directors, how much you're paying them, how much you're paying on fuel and maintenance. So all of those, in fact, in some businesses, I had some things that are peculiar to their own, so there might be a bit of tweak I can add or remove some things. So if I know that your company doesn't maybe have directors, though I will leave it because normally you should have, so in the future you might have, but maybe you don't need any regulatory and permits, then I remove this, you know. So you get that approach, you get that part. Then there's the marketing expenses too. So we want you to be, again, state out what your marketing plans are. So this usually forces the company owners, the people you are modeling for, to start all those their big plans that they put in the business plans. If you want to do modeling, don't let people send you their business plan. Even if they send it to you, still always ask them to fill these things. Because you will see someone say, okay, we are going to spend 5 million naira on, or 20 million naira on vehicles in year one to year two. That doesn't make sense for me in financial model. I need to know the exact period you are spending, because that's how I'll be able to do the depreciation. And then, we are going to borrow, we need to raise like 200 million naira in the first year or in the first 3 years. You know, again, so there are so many things that they write in the business plan that makes sense for a business plan, but when you want to do your financial model, it's not useful. You need them to match what they want to do with the timing. And in fact, if I'm doing for a startup, I would rather prefer they tell me the month. So that if you say you are going to set up your factory in year 2020, the month is important. If you set it up, if you complete setting it up in April, then you will be able to produce for like 8 months that year. But if when you complete setting it up in October, you only produce for 2 months. So I will know how much I'm going to put in forecast in my expectation of how much units you will produce. But when they are doing financial plan, they don't write it that way. They just write, this is our big plan. You know, we've engaged a Tetra Pak. You know, this, they put pictures, they put evidences, they put some things about the setup contract, and then they put all those things. But for me, I don't care about those ones. What I care about is in the amount and the timing. So when you send them this input sheet, it forces them to start giving you what you want. So otherwise, you will be almost doing double work. You will now have to start looking through their model, business plan, and extracting. And then when you can't find the date, you will now be calling at every juncture and be calling, okay, I see that you want to spend 50 million, but you didn't state exactly when you spend it, or you are going to borrow money. And then you didn't tell us you know, is there a moratorium to the loan? What is the interest rate? You just said Stanbic IBTC has agreed to give us a loan of 200 million naira, and then we're going to get it in 2020. I need to know when in 2020. So is your interest going to start coming from that year or not, you know, repayment? So all those information are why we, I can give you what the input, I'll send you this. So I'll send you this in the, I don't know how to send it now. I'll find a way to send it to us so that at least you get an idea around how you can capture everything you need for this number one type of model. This one, a proper financial model. Okay. And then there's the loan. And when you're getting the loan, you want to know what the actual loan you're going to raise is. And if they are going to be able to raise another one, you know, there are some loans that you keep renewing kind of. So this gives you that possibility that you can keep adding another one in the game. And then repayment, interest rate, what's the effective rate, what's the duration. And this automatically completes itself when you fill them in. Then in case they want to raise additional loans, they have space to put them. Do they have a bank overdraft, you know, facility? Yeah. Are they going to be saving their excess cash in an interest-bearing account? Great. What is the interest rate in that account? You know, are they going to raise equity? You know, so there's common shares, there are preference shares. So which ones, you know, so that they give you the conditions, because preference shares typically come with a commitment of dividend yield, whereas common shares most times do not come with any commitment of dividend. So you don't capture them the same way. And if you're raising, like I work with a PE private equity / VC company that focuses on West Africa, and when they want to invest in companies, they like to put their money in as preference shares because it gets more protection. And then sometimes they do revenue-based funding. So all these things are, if you have put them here, it can capture those dynamics. Then capital expenditure. So all the kind of capital assets that they're going to buy, you know, how much, and then what's the depreciation here? Because you need this to flex, to be able to flesh out the depreciation schedule. So all of that you need. Then also the working capital days. Typically, you want the business owner to tell you. So like for me, I'm a bit knowledgeable in some businesses, but not in some. So I know that if you are running a kind of a grocery, so a supermarket, most likely your day sales outstanding, your customers, how much it takes your customer to pay you. You know, it can be as low, it can be really low. You can decide that you never sell on credit. So that makes it to be zero, right? But then you can decide that your suppliers, you can agree with them that you pay them. In fact, most FMCG allow their big customers to some credit line. You can buy maybe 200 million, 2 million naira worth of goods and take like 1 week to pay back. So they give you some credit line. So which means that you can have days payable outstanding, you know, how many days it takes you to pay your suppliers, can be more than your day sales outstanding. But then if you're in another kind of business, you know, where people will hold you, maybe you are a Julius Berger or you're in construction, you know, that kind of business, people will probably never pay you everything up front. You know, they can pay you in trenches, in like milestones, they can pay you in, you will typically have to use your own money sometimes to execute the project and get money back. So you find out that the dynamics changes. So you typically want to explain what this means. So especially these three. These ones you can use if the business is very simple, you might even put it zero that they won't have anything in other current asset or other. But inventory, you know, how many days inventory are they going to hold? So if you know that the business is a business where they do like drop shipping, like they don't have warehouse, they buy directly from their supplier and they ship directly to the customer. So inventory, days inventory outstanding will be zero, right? So all these things now are what we use to forecast the working capital, how much inventory you will have, how much. So if you typically have a 1 month, you know, net 30 payment terms, people pay you 30 days after you deliver the job. Or maybe you do a postpaid service. So like those of us that maybe we use postpaid in terms of our maybe our internet, though internet people will not like that. But let's talk about, say, even our NEPA kind of electricity. So if you're modeling for NEPA now, the customer will use the service for 1 month and they pay after. They don't pay you upfront except for those who are unprepaid. So typically, you know, there will be figure here. So let's say you get your money exactly 1 month after. So that means if you have made, you know, 100 million naira per month, the 100 million naira in December, the money will come in January. So that figure will sit in receivable when you are already doing your end of year financial. So all these things are now how you're able to forecast. So when they give you all of these, then boom, you have all the information you need. Then let's go and look at any question at this juncture. How do you get long-term? Okay. So how do you get long-term? Do you apply a growth rate to all these annual expenses? If yes, on what basis? Okay. Then Matthew says, how do you get long-term inflation rate, growth rate, as well as long-term GDP growth rate? So let's start with the first question. Did you apply a growth rate to all these annual expenses? If yes, on what basis? So let's go take a look at the expenses. Let me even go to the original model. So there are two categories of expenses. There is the cost of sales. There is the one that is variable expense, variable and cost of goods sold. Then there will be other classes of variable, but not really. It depends on the company's strategy. So variable that can fall in the SG&A category. So if as a company we commit to spending 10% of our revenue on marketing, then that marketing expense becomes a variable. And then there will be fixed expenses. So especially all those capital capex, and again, some SG&A can be fixed. So whether you sell 100 million or you sell 1 billion, you will definitely need to have one CFO, one MD, one. So there are some expenses that don't really adjust. So some of your personal expenses will not adjust with that. Maybe some other expenses in your SG&A will not adjust on a variable level with your revenue. So now, all these three, you know, though there are two categories, but let's say three based on the nature, right? So for the cost of goods sold, it's always tied to the volume produced. If I sell, so if you can see my video now, I'm holding a picnic. Let me hold something that is by our good customer, Top Tea. So Promacido is one of our very good clients. So I'm holding Top Tea, right? If this cost, so they write the cost 180 naira. If the company, it costs the company, say, 90 naira, half of this amount to produce, which means that their variable, the cost of goods sold, is 90 naira, half of the revenue. Then you will find out that if I'm projecting that we will grow, maybe revenue this year is 100 million naira, and we are projecting that we'll do 200 million naira next year, then obviously it will be half of that 200 million naira that will be this cost of goods sold. So you see that this particular type of expense, this cost of goods sold, is usually tied to the volume of production. Okay, so that's that one. Then the ones that are under SG&A, so let's go to SG&A, right? You'll find out that, again, the nature determines it. Okay, so for consulting and professional fees, if it's the money you pay to your auditors, and then maybe money you pay to which other kind of common people fall under here, let's just leave it as auditors and your lawyer and those who help you with the legal filing and taxing and all of that. So again, whether your business grows or does not, typically their rates are a bit fixed. At least that has been our experience. So for the last 4 years, we've been paying the same amount to our tax professionals, and even the lawyers, being because almost like a family friend, she's been very kind to us. But the truth is, the amount we pay has never really like go up in tandem with whether our revenue goes up or down. Even this year, that sales is going to go down. Well, hopefully, it should come back up. But our tax guy is not telling us that our expense will be reduced. So you find out that some are flat. So this kind of expense can be really flat. It might not go up and down in tandem with your revenue. Director's fees can be flat again because, you know, but this one, you find out that if your company is going to grow in sales, typically you probably spend more too in terms of marketing, in terms of activities of your staff. You might even need to hire more staff and have official vehicles, and they use, even maybe you might need to get a larger office space and get a larger generator and more maintenance, more AC, more everything. So you find out that this one can also expand in tandem with your company operations. And then definitely these two are such kind of expenses. So typically you start with the nature. There are some expenses that they will remain flat. There are some that we expand in tandem with your revenue. There are some that we just go up in tandem with general environment, inflation, things like that. So things like rent, sometimes it goes up more in some average rates, you know, and then some other things too, we go up in that kind. So even like office expenses, you know, it might not necessarily go up because your sales have gone up. If you know that you're not hiring more hands, kind of, or you're not hiring more back-end staff. So you might just see that it's the same printers, the same things you are replacing, but now you'll be replacing them at the current price, you know, which is inflation driven. So you find out that some people are trying to join. Let me just admit that the person has given up. So someone was trying to join before, and let me see if I can set it that they don't need my permission to join. Okay, so I hope I've answered the question. So the thing is the nature. There will be some expenses that they go up because your sales have gone up, and there will be some expenses that's not what we make them go up. So, and okay. Let me just go check. So one other person has asked a question. Okay. Hi, Mike. Let me go in the other. How do you get long-term inflation growth rate as well as long-term GDP growth rate in assuming the growth rate for this year valuation? Okay, so let's go check that. So before I go there, because I can see I'm almost running out of time, I have 10 minutes. I just want to also mention the part that I said I was going to show us. There are two things I was supposed to show us, for a manufacturing company and then for a SaaS company. So for a software as a service company, this is the structure. Can you see that this structure is different from the kind of company we just finished talking about? So if you are a software as a service company, so you are this. So for you, someone is trying to join. Let me quickly admit them here. Admit. Great. So if you are this kind of company, software as a service. Well, what do you mean by software as a service? I sell something like QuickBooks Online. It's not common in Nigeria yet. But then again, that's it now. Things catch up late here, but this is how it works. You might have a client that has the nature of his business where people need to be paying monthly for the service. So I subscribe to, like for us as a company, our QuickBooks, our accounting software, subscription based, MailChimp. There are so many things we use, you know, email marketing software, social media marketing tools that we use that will pay per month. So for those kind of people, this is how they model their own financials. How many new customers they are getting every month? Then what is the cost of acquiring new customer? So they are much more deliberate about how they get new customer. They could say they want to spend $1 or $10 to get a new customer. So that $10 could mean we spend it on Google adverts. We pay some third party marketing people to maybe go on the streets and give flyers out, and we calculate how much they will get for us and break it down to a per customer acquisition. So that's why it's called customer acquisition, because it's a very big thing in a SaaS software as a service and model. Then there's the monthly renewing customer. So your existing customers, then how much are you still making? So existing customers, how many are they? And then you know, from there you'll be able to know how much you are getting from your existing customer base. So those existing customer base, you've already paid the price of acquiring them. So this cost is only going to affect new customers you get. While these ones, that's why they say the customer you have is the cheapest one. You know, the ones you don't have are more expensive than the ones you already have. So you find out that companies typically try to do a lot of upselling and cross-selling. Oh, you're already on this plan. You know what? If you move to this higher plan, you get more benefit, or you already use product one from us. Do you know we have another product too? So that's one they don't get. They don't have to go and pay the advertising to do that. They already have your details and they can, you know, inform you. So that's this one. Then churn customers. So obviously some customers, we cancel their subscription. Like for us, we used to use Pipedrive for our CRM, customer relationship management. When this coronavirus happened, we had to cancel because it became there's one other product too we used that, you know, the price was really high. Even when Corona was not yet here, it was high, but well, revenue was good, so we could always know that, okay, from this and that we can always pay it. But when Corona hit, it didn't take us time to go and cancel it. So it happens that sometimes customers, it could be they genuinely don't want your product again, they cancel, or it could be they can't afford to pay anymore. Some of us use Netflix, some of us have had to cancel. I will cancel, then I'll come back again. That thing is addictive. So, for them, they capture it because sometimes they do some marketing that targets reactivating chunk customers. So they can, that's why sometimes I've seen Netflix do it, that they will tell me that, okay, you know what, I can come back and I will get, Apple Music does that. They will say, oh, if I come back, I'll get 1 month free. So why are they, is it everybody they are sending that to? No, they send that only to their churned customers. They will not send it to a customer that is already paying. Why are you giving somebody who is paying 1 month free? So you give it to someone who has gone, so they capture that so that they can do, and then the average revenue per customer. So this one factors in, different customers might come in at different price points. We could be doing a Democracy Day discount, and some people, that's how they came in. So they come in at a discounted plan. We could be doing, if you pay 1 year, you'll be paying at $10 per month. But if you pay 1 month at a time, you're paying $15. So that's common too. So because of all those differences, you find out that in doing this model, the company has to put in what is their average revenue per customer. So that way they get a lot more flexibility on their discounting. And sometimes some people even do affiliate sales where when you partner with some companies or some other parties, and when they bring you sale, you give them a cut of it. So because of all those many things, you will typically not put your listed price as your revenue, like what you charge per customer, to be what is the actual money that comes to you. Then there's now this MRR, monthly recurring revenue. So these are the things that capture all of that. I was still working on this, so that's why I have just finished for product. So I'm just going to replicate this for this and this. And so this is what I'm going to use for teaching that pro course that I have to render later on. I think it's this year that I have to deliver it. I mean, this month. Where is the date again? 28th of July. So this is the model that they will use, because for Nigeria, I don't know of any business that currently I don't know. Even then, Paystack and the rest. It's a bit difficult because what they earn is commissions on transaction. They are not, their own is not a subscription service. So it's not yet catch up in Nigeria. We used to do it for one of our product, but nobody paid. So we decided to sell one off. All right. So now my mind is clear. I've done that part. Okay. So how do we get a long-term inflation growth rate? If you have any question, please put them now, because we have just like 5 minutes to round off. Okay, so how do we get long-term growth rate, and how do we get GDP? So when we're doing valuation, there's this thing called the terminal growth rate. where you say, okay, I forecasted for this company for 6 years, but the company is going to keep existing. But then you can't keep forecasting into the future. You will always be wrong. And so there's this rule of thumb that we just do the terminal growth rate. So we say, okay, after 6 years, this company is supposed to be able to maintain long-term growth rate of, say, maybe 5%. Now, this growth rate is a combination of, is calculated or is estimated based on the long-term inflation and then long-term GDP. So typically, no company should be able to do more than the two. No company should be able to grow faster than the GDP and the inflation rate of the economy they operate in. Otherwise, the company will be bigger than the country. So where are you making the money from if you are bigger than Nigeria? You have a company in Nigeria and the company is bigger than Nigeria and Nigeria is the customer base. You know, it makes no sense. It's like saying a tree will grow forever into the sky. So for Nigeria, right, you benefit from using our tool. So we have these two, Nigeria Market Data. If you go to App Store, if you go to this in your Excel, if you go to Insert, so if you go to Insert, and if you go to this Get Add-ins, that's where you'll find the tool. So if you go to Get Add-ins, and then when you reach here, just type Nigeria in the search box. It will come up. So I'm going to type Nigeria. Research, it will come up. So you just had it. I already have it, so I'm not going to add it again. But in your own case, you will need to click on add. And it also works on Excel online. So you don't necessarily, in case if your Excel is not Office 365 or 2016, because it's 2016 and above, you can just go to web and just type Excel online. Excel online. Once you type Excel online, it will come up here. So you see Office Alive, click on it, you'll get Excel online. And you can do the same thing I've just shown you. So you are not limited to just your computer, especially if your version of Excel on your computer is kind of old. So okay, it's asking me to sign in. I'm not going to worry about that. So let me show you how you get the long-term inflation growth. You can see here there is inflation, right? If I click on inflation, it's going to pull it out. That's strange. Okay, great. I was wondering why is it not coming up. Let me see if I have my stuff on. Okay, this is right. So that thing helps to speed up my computer. So once I have this, what do I do? All I just do is I do, what's the average? So what is our average inflation rate for as far back as I have data for? So this is as far, it's still coming up because I think I have as far back as anyway, I have it further than this. So maybe because I'm streaming again live, that's why it's slow a bit. So I think I have as far back as 2004 or something. So, but then again, this is the tool I used to get it. So I get our long-term inflation rate. Then what about the GDP? What do? I go here and I say GDP, where is GDP? Yeah, GDP growth rate. And then that one too comes up. Maybe I should just let it finish before I do any formula on it. Maybe that's what broke this one. So it's populating. So you have the Nigerian GDP rate. And then what do? Similar thing, I just do average of that. Go. You even see this one, I have it as far back as 1986. And then with that, I now have what the. So if it's a company that I think what they are doing is very sustainable, like they are going to be there 20, 40 years, then I can go to the higher end. I can pick something closer to this upper limit. If it's a company that their business model is something that can be easily eroded, I can stay towards the lower rate, lower boundary. So I could decide to keep this on at 5%. So that's the way we go about getting. There is no exact formula. The only thing is just the long, get something between the two. And then,
sorry, Mike, can I button, please?
Okay, yes, you can.
The source of your data for GDP and inflation, it's not on the screen that you are showing for this display. So I think we are missing that source.
Can you see my screen now?
Yes, I can see you.
What do you see on my screen currently?
I see you.
You see and, me?
In front of it.
You don't see an Excel sheet?
I'm seeing you at the background while I have a display. Okay, yeah, I see at the Excel sheet now.
Okay, you see the Excel sheet. Yeah, what about everybody else? Everybody else, can you see the Excel sheet?
Yes, we can see it.
Yeah, we can see it, but... okay, we can see it.
Okay, great then. All right, so the source is this app, which we built ourselves, but we all know that the ultimate source is NBS, Nigerian Bureau of Statistics. So that's the ultimate source of the data anyway. It's just that we are aggregating it. So for inflation is NBS. For GDP is also, they are the ones that release GDP. It's only interest rates that is CBN that we get that one from. So all this information that you are seeing is just so that it makes it easy for people like me and you, who we already have Excel, instead of going and fishing them online, you just have this tool and you can extract them into your Excel really fast. Okay, so I'm going to go back here and so let me just go check for any other questions. People are back. I need to round up. We have another one in about 50 something minutes. Okay, so Mr. Matthew, good. I hope that addresses your question. So SK, hi Michael, can we get a few templates or samples of this financial modeling as you had mentioned? I will give us sample of the the input sheets. But if you are on our training, you will get the one for the for this entire financial, this one, this completed one, you will have it. But if you are not doing our training, I'll give you the input sheet. So for you to get it, the only thing you need to do is make sure you are on this community, because I will just email it to everybody in the community. So make sure you are on this community. If you are on this community, I've posted the joining link, then you will get it. Then also, you can get our training. We have a free teaser. What I say free teaser, like without you paying, you can do a portion of our training. And I don't think it comes with the template, but at least it explains more than what I'm explaining in these 30 minutes. So let me just show you. I'm going to grab the link and give you. So for the Power BI, for the financial modeling, this is the free teaser course. So from there, you can get more explanations, and you might be lucky that the explanation is enough without you having to go and pay for the full course. So how do I join the committee? Yeah, I've pasted the link. Which other questions are there? Okay, so Rodney is asking, in an instance where you have a foreign investor, US-based, who has asked for a financial model in Naira, how do you factor in changes in inflation and exchange rate fluctuation? Perfect question. Actually, you will not care about inflation. You will care about exchange rate, because your business is in Nigeria, is in Naira here. So inflation doesn't affect you. Inflation is not what you care about, kind of, anyway. So what we usually do is... in the input menu, it's just that I can't show you a live client one. You see, before you even start doing, use this one so I don't go and mess that one up. Before you start doing all these unit economics, you are going to do exchange rates. You're going to create exchange rates. So if the company is interested in dollars, so you peg yours to dollars, and then you put the, so maybe you think it's going to be 440 here, maybe you think it would be 470 here, and then like that. So you put the rate there, and then in the scenarios, you're also going to include the rate in the scenario. So in the scenario, maybe up to this one that we put there might be conservative. Then optimistic might be maybe 400, the pessimistic might be 550. So you will just make sure that you put them there. So that way, the customer can be able to see how all this is revenue and all of this will translate to dollars at the prevailing exchange rate. We're able to see the expenses in dollar equivalent, the revenue in dollar equivalent, and that's just what they want. So it's a very common thing, and that's how we tackle it. And I think we'll have to start rounding up now. Anybody have any questions again? I'm going to upload the recording in the group. Like I said, if you join that online community, because it's a lot easier for me to just mail it to everybody via this. So I even hold some people, the ones we've done before, some of the guests sent us their own slides. So it will even be an opportunity for me to send all of the backlogs and this new one to everybody at the same time. So we want to round up now then. Any question or anybody has something they've experienced that they want to share with the house? You know, because like I said, we don't want this to be only me talking. I'm not the only one who knows financial modeling. Some people already do it too. And so if you have anything you feel others can benefit from, I can spare some 5 minutes. No more questions I've answered. I think I've tackled all the... Someone said, please, how do I remove my workbook from read-only? Just do enable edit, because maybe you downloaded the file, and nowadays Excel will not let you edit the downloaded file unless you click enable edit. All right, so are we saying it's good to close at this juncture? Okay, so thank you very much, everybody. If you are interested in the next one is Excel. If you're interested in Microsoft Excel, you know, so the next meetup we have right now by 4 o'clock, it's Excel. If you're interested in that, I'm going to give you the joining link. So there are some new tools that Excel has added. Let me try and show you some. You'll be amazed. You know, the way Microsoft is just adding new things to Excel. If you are not a full-time consultant like me, you will be behind the curve. Like, you'll just be like, your jaws will be on the ground when I show you what they've added. You'll be like, hey, you don't know Excel again, no. That's the way it will come across to you. Can you see this stuff? So this is how when somebody is passworded, you start seeing these padlocks icons. Then there are some new things too. They now have sheet view. So there are so many new things, new formulas, new features that those who are interested in that session, you want to join. Let me just give you the joining link. So if you're interested in the Excel meetup that is going to come up, session that will come up in like less than 1 hour from now, 4 p.m. So join the Excel. And the meetup link is, let me just get that one for us. The team session, you know, the way you join this one via one particular short link. So that's one too, when it's time and you want to join, this is the Teams session joining link.
Hello, Michael.
Yes, sir. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, I just want to say, I can't see the chat.
You can't see the chat?
Yes, I can.
Okay, great. Can you see my screen? You're not sharing screen. Great. Do you have this type of stuff in yours?
No, I don't. It's just like the screen.
It's like what, sir?
It's just I don't have all the cutouts. What I just have is the below saying like the.
Okay. Read for me what you have. Tell me what you have, so I can know which one.
Yeah, I only have the three dotted mark, and I don't have the chat. I don't have the raising hand.
Good. Click on that three dotted stuff.
Yes, I've clicked on it.
What came out?
show device settings, enter full screen, show background effects, keypad, and turn off incoming screen.
Nothing like chat there.
No chat. I don't know why it's like that. I've been trying to, I don't want to talk since, but.
I think he can, he should look up the screen. You see the chat box up your screen.
Oh, there's nothing on my screen. Right. Even like the icons you have on the left, that's stickers and other things, I can't see that.
Okay, that's great. Okay, let me just quickly ask you, can you see my screen?
Yes, I can. Your screen?
Okay,
yes,
great. I want to ask you, have you joined this particular meetup?
I haven't joined it. Let me try it. I'll join it. So,
join it. So the thing is, all what I said here, all the things I pasted, I will send to everybody here. Because of you now, I will make sure even the links I dropped here, I send it again in that place. And anything that I've put here that you could have missed because you couldn't see the chat box, I will make sure that in the email I sent out, you get it. So that way, at least, you don't miss out on anything. So I think we close the session now. Johnson says he joined very late. Yes, there will be a recording. So I'll just edit the recording to cut out so that people will not be bored and to just have only the main content. All right. So thank you very, very much. And we draw the curtain here. So see you next week. And if you are interested in the Excel one, make sure the Excel one will start 4 o'clock. So make sure you join this one too. And then you see the joining link. So thank you and have a nice Sunday. Thank you very much. How do I get the link for the Power BI one? Okay, let me also get it. The Power BI one is going to come up 6 p.m. today. So that one, for those who are interested in Power BI, you can also join that. And at least, even if you are not interested, you at least can be aware of what's happening in that space so that nobody will just be talking things that are above your head when suddenly your company, somebody start talking about Power BI and like, okay, the way the person is talking about it, this looks like something you don't know, but if you join this webinar, you'll be able to be aware of all of those things. So thank you very much. I need to wrap it up so that I can prepare for the Excel people's one, because I have to do a lot of demo for them. So I greatly appreciate everybody who joined. See you again, same station, same time next week. Bye-bye.